There's a recent study, some research conducted by MIT on the impact of ChatGPT in that study, but of large language models in general, in the end, on our brain. On our brain when performing certain tasks for which we typically need our brain. In this study, it's about writing essays, because of course that is something where LLMs are really good at, amongst many other things. And in that study, I guess kind of unsurprisingly, MIT found that using a large language model like ChatGPT here can make you dumber, so to say. Or, to be precise, shows that there is way less brain activity than if you're not using a large language model for a certain task. Now, that's probably not some groundbreaking, extremely surprising finding, but still, it's nice to see a study where this is actively researched and measured, where brain activity is measured, and I want to share my views or my thoughts on that and some ideas on how we should deal with large language models, also in the context of writing code, in the context of programming, because that's what I typically do. So, first things first, how was this study structured? What exactly did they do there? Well, they created three groups of participants. And just to be clear, in this study, they only had 54 participants, so it's not a huge study, but still, the findings are quite interesting. So, they divided these 54 people into three groups. One group was allowed to use large language models and only use large language models to complete their tasks, which was to write some essays. So they only had access to ChatGPT specifically. They did not have access to web search outside of ChatGPT or any other websites or tools, except for a tool to write the essay, of course. Then there was a group which did explicitly not have access to any large language models, so not to ChatGPT, not to Gemini, X, AI's Grok, and so on. Instead, they only had access to web search and all other websites, or I should say, they had access to every website except for AI chatbots of any kind, and of course, to their brain, all groups had access to that. And then the third group only had access to their own brain. So they did not have any internet access. They did not have access to web search, any websites, or to ChatGPT or other large language models. These were the three groups: the large language model group, the search engine group, and the brain only group. And then they had three sessions per group. And in each session, each group had to write an essay, a short essay on a topic that was taken from the SAT tests. And I'm not American, but I learned that this seems to be the Scholastic Assessment Test, which is a standardized test widely used for college admissions, primarily in the United States. Okay, so that's essentially a test that seems to be fairly standard in the US. I don't know, but the topics on which the participants had to write essays were taken from that test. So they were not made up by the researchers, by the MIT, but instead taken from that test set. And then for each session, each participant could choose between three different topics, and they then had to write an essay on that topic. And they had 20 minutes of time for that, which of course is not super long, especially if you don't have access to a large language model, but they were told to simply try their best and yeah, go from there. So that was the structure of this study, of this research. And now, what do you think the findings were? Well, as I mentioned initially, unsurprisingly, for the large language model group, it was pretty obvious that most of them did just copy and paste the essay that was written by ChatGPT. There was barely any editing. They did not really know a lot about their essay, so As part of the study, the researchers tested whether they were able to quote from their essay, and they were not really able to do that well, whereas the people that only used their brain were able to quote almost perfectly, because of course they wrote everything on their own. The large language model group didn't do that. There also was less ownership in the produced work, because again, the large language model group didn't really produce it. ChatGPT produced it, right? And brain activity was measured, and that's the interesting part. So brain activity was measured, and there was way less brain activity in the large language model group than in the search engine group, and of course, specifically also the brain-only group. Unsurprisingly, the brain-only group had the highest degree of brain activity, but for the large language model group, it was particularly low. And again, these are all not findings that you wouldn't have expected, I guess. At least for me, they're not super shocking. Again, still, it's nice to see that researched and actually measured, because there is a difference between researching and measuring and guessing. But still, not super surprising. But of course, it also means that we as a society, I guess, have a problem due to all these large language models, because of course we're all using them. You're probably using them every day, I certainly do, and I also use them a lot for coding, for generating code. And when it comes to coding, to developing, then there are different degrees of usage I identify for myself, at least. The base level, kind of, you could say, is that you only use AI assistance for auto completion. So you write some code, and then you all know some completions pop up from time to time if you're using Cursor or GitHub Copilot and so on. And then you might hit the tab key to accept them. And these completions are not necessarily just for a single word or just a line of code, but as you know, it could be an entire block of code that's being suggested. Or all these tools typically nowadays also have next edit suggestions, where they even suggest you which other part of your program you might want to edit now that you accepted a certain other edit. So that's kind of the base level of usage. But then, of course, you can ramp it up and you can have the AI generate more and more code. You can use agentic mode, which also is integrated in all modern AI IDEs nowadays. And you can just give the AI a task like add login to this web app, and it will go ahead and generate all the code in different files that's needed for that. And I also use this feature, but what I found is totally in line with this study, because if I have AI write significant parts of my code, I don't know anything about that code. I tend to just accept it and then try whether it works and only then dive into the code. And I also found that sometimes I might actually be slower than if I had written the code myself right from the start, because if things don't work, or if there's a security issue or some bug in that code, or if I'm just not happy with it, if I don't like the layout or the look of the web app that was produced, for example, then because I know so little about that code, it takes me way longer to get into it. It's essentially as if I had to dive into code that was written by a totally different person, maybe a person that didn't write very good code to some degree, and it takes me longer to get into that code and adjust it than it might have taken me if I had written it right from the start. Now, the balance here is really difficult, because A, I don't know if that's true, it's just how it feels, and B, if you have AI write small chunks of code here and there, you can definitely be more efficient and faster than if you had written everything from scratch on your own. But it's so hard to get the balance right. I constantly fall into the trap of asking for more and more and more code to be written by the AI, and the chunks of code it generates, they often get bigger and bigger and bigger, and then I'm back at the point where I feel like, man, I should have written that myself, where I should have asked for smaller changes, for smaller chunks of code. So It's really hard, at least for me, to get that balance right and to just use AI tools for small features and not for large changes, because of course it's so convenient. You just describe a problem, you lean back, you do something else maybe, you can maybe even work on another feature and you feel very productive, but then you lose time and it's not really a lot of fun to do code reviews, to be honest. You lose time and you don't have fun because you have to go through all the code that was generated, you might need to change a lot, and I don't know about it. And that study is essentially in line with that feeling I definitely have from time to time, and you also might have from time to time. Now, I'm not saying, and the study is also not saying that, by the way, that we should all stop using AI tools, that we should stop using ChatGPT and so on. We should definitely not do that. But as a society, as people in general, now that these tools are there and that they're getting better and that they're not going away, sorry, we have to learn how to best work with them. Because at the moment, it feels a bit like we're in the state of actually flipped roles. We, the humans, are not guiding the AI, at least often that is what happens. Instead, we're just sitting there and we're reacting to what the AI generated, what the AI gave us. And I'm not sure if that really is the path we want to go down. That's maybe not really how it should be. It should be the other way around. We as humans should be guiding the AI. We should be using it as a helper, and we should maybe use it to review our work, not the other way around. But it's, again, it's so convenient to fall into that trap. I mean, falling into the trap is not convenient, but it's so convenient to use the AI for everything, and that's then how you fall into that trap. So that is something we need to get better, and that is something we need to learn. Because one future that does not look super intriguing to me is a future where I lost my ability to think and to solve problems, because that's a future where you're pretty worthless to some degree. No, not as a human being in general. I mean, worthless in your current job or as a critical thinking human being. I don't want to outsource my thinking capabilities to some AI, but that is to some degree what's happening right now. And that is therefore something you actively have to watch out for and to be careful about. And in the context of coding, but I guess in general of using the AI, for me, that means that I want to force myself to actively not use AI for certain tasks or problems I'm facing. I could, for example, ask an AI to add a certain screen to my web app, but I'm not doing that. At least I try to force myself to not always ask for help. Instead, I try writing it on my own. I use tab completions, and I am actually then also often using an AI for feedback on the code I wrote or to analyze the code base I have, also to catch potential security issues as an additional set of eyes, so to say. But I try to force myself to not use AI for everything. I also try to get more and more into the habit of using AI for initial planning instead of execution. Because, again, having AI execute everything means that AI owns the work and I don't know a lot about it. At least that's the danger. If I instead use it for planning, for research, for writing and improving a plan, so not for writing a plan and blindly accepting it, but instead for maybe writing a rough plan myself and then have AI refine it, that's something that works really well for me. So again, in the context of writing code, I might be working on a certain feature and I then write step by step how that feature works, what it's about, which kind of sub features need to be implemented, what to watch out for, and so on. I then feed that to an AI to get some feedback by the AI, get some refinements, some additional ideas, and then I execute that plan. And that's again the part where I then try to force myself that I execute it and I don't feed it to the AI and have it do everything. Now, I know on X, out there in the world in general, you'll find many people that tell you that you should kind of embrace the opposite. You should use AI for everything, right? We're in the year of AI agents, so we want to have an AI agent for everything. But we're definitely not there yet, in my opinion, that AI agents are as capable as some people try to make us believe. And even if they were, you should always think carefully about the role you want to have. Do you want to be that passive person that just reviews the work done by AI? Or do you want to be at the steering wheel? Do you want to control the AI and your work? Ultimately, you will grow more, you will learn more, and you will be worth more on the job market, for example, if you are the pilot, if you know what you're doing, if you have deep knowledge, and if you're able to use AI to leverage that, then the other way around. That is my belief, and that's ultimately also what this study kind of proved to me. Now, if you are interested, of course, you can read that study in detail. You can feed it to ChatGPT to analyze it, which is kind of ironic, but of course, it also kind of makes sense because that is one part where large language models are really great at. But I hope that these insights maybe were helpful. I'm super interested in hearing your thoughts on this topic in general and this study maybe. And I'll see you, hear you again in the future, hopefully.